Some time ago, we published a video praising AMD's first generation Ryzen for forcing Intel to compete and offer better prices and faster products. You can watch that later if you haven't already. Have AMD done it again with Ryzen 3000? Yes, sort of. In many ways, Ryzen 3000 feels like an echo of the first generation. For the second time, AMD has set a new record in core count for mainstream processors. For the second time, the Ryzen flagship has offered 4 more cores and 8 more threads than the Intel flagship. For the second time, or maybe even third time, AMD has crushed Intel in multi-threaded performance and even in certain single-threaded benchmarks, though this hasn't always translated in gaming performance. That being said, this is the third time AMD has shrunk Intel's lead in gaming, even if Ryzen hasn't caught up in the majority of titles. Most reviews have heaped glowing praise on AMD. We'll do things a little differently by looking at where third-gen Ryzen fell short and why it matters. Has Ryzen 3000 disrupted performance to price segments like the first generation, though? That depends on your expectations and your needs. Do you render 3D a lot? Then yes, Ryzen 3700X and 3900X are a godsend. Are you a developer or programmer? Ryzen is the obvious choice. Do you work with Adobe Premiere? Then maybe, if you don't value Intel's quick sync acceleration. If you do, Intel's integrated graphics enable the 9900K to take less than half the time taken by the 12-core Ryzen flagship to compete the same workload.
I was sure to enable hardware encoding, which requires the install and activation of Intel UHD graphics. There are typically drivers involved along with a BIOS toggle, so it's a multi-step process. That said, it works wonders here, and I'm getting less than a minute for minute render time per minute of footage on my timeline with the 9900K. And this is something comparable AMD chips simply cannot take part in. For that reason, and that reason alone, I haven't switched to Ryzen or Zen 2 for my personal editing rig.
Do you work with Photoshop? Intel still holds the lead there, as is the case with gaming performance. A Reddit user averaged benchmarks from 12 different reviews and found Ryzen to fall behind Intel in most of the 29 titles tested. The 3900X trailed the 9900K in 22 titles looking at average frames on 1080p. On average, the 3900X was 3.71% behind the Intel flagship. Rainbow Six Siege was the best result for the 3900X, an 11.87% average lead over the 9900K. This paled in comparison to the 9900K's best result, a 14.64% lead in Far Cry. This harkens back to what Intel's vice president of marketing said. If they want this crown, come beat us in real-world gaming. Real-world gaming should be the defining criteria that we use to assess the world's best gaming CPU. That's the measure we're going to stand by. He knew what he was talking about, and he played his card well. Intel's lead grew to 5.32% looking at the 1% low frame rate results from 12 reviews. The 3900X came out ahead in only 5 of the 22 games benchmarked, often by an insignificant margin. For instance, the 3900X was 1.3% faster in Assassin's Creed and 0.93% faster in Total War 3 Kingdoms. Even at its best, the 3900X was only 6.23% faster at Forza Horizon 4, 6.3% faster at Resident Evil 2, and 7.25% faster at Final Fantasy 15. On the other hand, the 3900X was around 11% behind the 9900K at Rainbow Six Siege, Battlefield 5, and Far Cry, and over 14% behind in Shadow of the Tomb Raider and Project Cars 2. This is a gap that will only widen when overclocking comes into play. Intel's 9700K and 9900K can overclock to 5 GHz and beyond, given adequate cooling and power. In contrast, third generation Ryzen can barely overclock at all, as most reviewers only manage to squeeze around 4.3 GHz at best, well below the boost frequencies advertised by AMD. In fact, overclocking can reduce performance in certain scenarios, as manual all-core overclocks prevent Ryzen from automatically boosting single cores to higher frequencies in lightly threaded tasks. It's ironic when one remembers AMD claiming Ryzen could automatically overclock higher than the advertised boost frequency with their new Precision Boost Overdrive, if the motherboard had extra capacity.
This little bar here is your CPU performance at stock. That is out of the box, brand new processor, and you haven't tweaked anything yet. What we do with Precision Boost Overdrive is let the CPU in the socket communicate with the motherboard to learn how much extra capacity is there. So if this is what the CPU is expecting, the motherboard might be able to provide this or this, a lot more, a lot extra. And that extra can be used to deliver more power to the socket, which allows, potentially, the CPU to run at a higher clock speed for a longer period of time. And more clock speed for longer means more performance. New and interesting in the Ryzen 3000 family is this idea that you can automatically overclock to PB here for precision boost. That's the highest clock speed you see printed on the box. And that could be, say, 4.55 gigahertz. Now, with this automatic overclocking feature that's new, what if you could plug in up to 200 megahertz of extra boost, and suddenly that's 4.75 gigahertz. You are overriding the boost clock. You're overclocking the number that's printed on the box.
Consumers who believed any of that must be disappointed by the reviews. Very few outlets could actually reach the advertised boost frequencies, let alone 4.75 gigahertz on any processor. AMD did say Precision Boost Overdrive relies on the quality of the motherboard.
You have a nice enthusiast AMD X570 motherboard.
But remember, AMD has an incentive to give reviewers the best hardware configuration, including the enthusiast X570 motherboards that AMD was talking about. AMD would obviously want to present their products in the best possible light. Even with ideal testing conditions, reviewers had a hard time reaching the boost frequencies advertised on Ryzen packages. If they couldn't hit AMD's advertised frequencies, then nobody can. If nobody can reach AMD's advertised frequencies, their marketing may not have been entirely accurate. This is disappointing compared to their Intel competition, which can boost all of its cores to the advertised single-core turbo frequency through multi-core enhancement provided by Z390 motherboards. Perhaps AMD should have specified their boost was peak frequency with an asterisk that referred to a footnote, clarifying this was a theoretical peak for a single core in lightly threaded workloads. Intel is far more transparent in this department, labeling their peak frequency the maximum single core turbo frequency. Some blame BIOS issues for Ryzen's inability to reach the advertised frequencies, but so far, there is no evidence to support this. Gamers Nexus tested two different versions and found little difference. Certainly not enough to give any legitimacy to the advertised boost clocks.
3900X would not hit 4.6 gigahertz in any condition. So AMD reached out to me after the test I performed after the video I showed online and asked if I could retest with the latest Agisa version, the 1003, which I did. Changing to the newer Agisa version, it also does not change. CPU is still at about 4.2, maybe boosts by 25 megahertz, but is far away from 4.4, 4.5, or even 4.6, which could be that the load to the cores is too high that it cannot boost to 4.5 or 4.6. I really have a lot of trouble to get this CPU to boost to 4.6. All of this was retail hardware. It was the retail latest BIOS. Considering that it's really so difficult to get the CPU to boost to 4.6, and I talked to other reviewers as well, a lot of people have trouble to get this CPU to always boost to 4.6. Typically, it just doesn't boost to 4.6.
The lower than expected frequencies explain why Ryzen hasn't yet caught up to Intel in most games. Ryzen 3000 isn't the slam dunk AMD fans have been holding out for. It's a tad disappointing that even at 7 nanometers, AMD's third attempt hasn't thoroughly surpassed a competitor that has stagnated on 14 nanometers for 4 years now. That's a harsh way of saying AMD has shrunk Intel's lead down to a few niches: hardware accelerated encoding and gaming with high refresh rates. In everything else, Ryzen leaves Intel in the dust, including mid-range gaming where the 3600 renders Intel's i5s and older quad cores irrelevant. Reviewers are correct in praising Ryzen for offering more value than Intel. Ryzen processors are bundled with one of their Wraith coolers that do a decent job of keeping thermals in check. In contrast, Intel does not provide any cooler with their unlocked chips, requiring you to spend more money beyond their MSRP. Furthermore, AMD designed their CPUs to be compatible with AM4, the platform they introduced with first-generation Ryzen. At its introduction, AMD announced AM4 would be the default socket for new Ryzen chips until at least 2020. Consequently, third generation Ryzen CPUs can be used on X470, B450, X370 and B350 boards, products that were introduced in 2018 and even 2017. None of this is new. All of these innovations and offerings were introduced with Ryzen's first generation. Ryzen 3000 feels more like an iteration of the same improvements brought by its predecessors, not the 7-nanometer revolution some may have hoped for. While some of this disappointment can be blamed on unrealistic expectations, AMD may have contributed to the problem with their misleading marketing. Getting back to backward compatibility though, while Ryzen CPUs may work with older motherboards, it has not worked both ways. AMD announced that the new X570 motherboards may not support first-generation Ryzen CPUs. Furthermore, the X570 platform seems to corrupt data on NVMe SSDs using PCIe, according to warnings issued by the Windows Hardware Error Architecture. AMD responded to these concerns and said they were looking into the Windows hardware errors, but declared they conclusively know it doesn't cause data loss. It is a bit disappointing Ryzen still runs into these teething issues with its third generation. However, consumers who commit to the platform and ride this out may benefit in the long run. In June 2019, AMD announced they might support AM4 well past 2020, saying, "It will really take a major inflection point in the platform technology for us to move off socket AM4. What does this mean? Anyone buying into AMD's platform can slot in newer Ryzen generations when they become available, without having to purchase another motherboard. This makes Ryzen's upgrade path simpler, easier, and much cheaper than Intel, a company that requires their customers purchase a new motherboard with each subsequent generation. Given the fact that Intel CPUs require its buyers spend additional money on cooling and a motherboard with a dead-end socket, it's ridiculous how Intel priced their 9th generation i7s. They may have shot themselves in the foot with their greed, since Intel CPUs would have been significantly more competitive if they were priced reasonably. If Intel hadn't introduced a more expensive segment with the i9 and merely continued increasing core counts with the 9th generation as they had done with the 8th, Ryzen 3000 would not have been the foregone conclusion it is now for the majority of consumers, bar the few niches we've already mentioned. At 6 cores and 12 threads, Intel's 8700K brought a 50% increase in core and thread counts over its quad-core predecessor, with a modest but understandable hike. For consumers who didn't care for hyper-threading, the 8600K brought a 50% increase in core count over the 7600K. Imagine if the 9th generation brought a similar improvement over Coffee Lake instead of the side grade it turned out to be. The 9700K should have been the 8-core 16-thread part, which would have justified the price premium over the 8700K. Intel did increase the i7's core count to 8, but disabled hyperthreading, which took the wind out of its sails. This 8-core 8-thread part should have been the i5-9600K, which would continue the 8600K's improvement over its quad-core predecessor. If Intel's 8-core 16-thread processor was priced under $400, it would be a compelling choice over the 3800X. At $480 though, the 9900K is not particularly compelling next to the similarly priced 3900X, a chip that has 50% more cores and threads. The 9900K looks even worse when you consider the number of security vulnerabilities that have come into light. Meltdown, Spectre, and most recently, Zombie Load. Zombie Load takes its name from a zombie load, an amount of data the processor can't understand or properly process, forcing the processor to ask for help from the processor's microcode to prevent a crash. Apps are usually only able to see their own data, but this bug allows that data to bleed across those boundary walls. Zombie Load will leak any data currently loaded by the processor's core, the researchers said. To be fair, Intel has released microcode to patch vulnerable processors, including Intel Xeon, Intel Broadwell, Sandy Bridge, Sky Lake, and Haswell chips. However, Intel said the microcode updates, like previous patches, would have an impact on processor performance. This doesn't seem to have satisfied Google, who took the extreme step of disabling hyperthreading on their Chromebooks. Similarly, performance on Apple's Macs could be hit by up to 40%. To be fair, AMD had their own security scandal in March 2018. When CTS Labs, a security research company, announced they had discovered 4 potential attacks, codenamed MasterKey, Ryzen Fall, Fallout and Chimera. CTS Labs published a white paper explaining what these flaws are. An attacker can use Ryzen Fall or Fallout to bypass Windows Credential Guard, steal network credentials, and then use these to move laterally through Windows-based enterprise networks. Ryzen Full 4, which achieves code execution inside the PSP, leads to all the attacker capabilities described above, as well as the capability to tamper with the PSP and the security features. If you're wondering what the PSP is, the AMD Platform Security Processor, officially known as AMD Secure Technology, is a trusted execution environment subsystem incorporated since about 2013 into AMD microprocessors. According to an AMD developer's guide, the subsystem is responsible for creating, monitoring, and maintaining the security environment. And its functions include managing the boot process, initializing various security-related mechanisms, and monitoring the system for any suspicious activity or events, and implementing an appropriate response. The PSP is an ARM core with TrustZone technology, built onto the main CPU die. As such, it has the ability to hide its own program code, scratch RAM, and any data it may have taken and stored from the lesser privileged x86 system RAM, kernel encryption keys, login data, browsing history, keystrokes, who knows? To make matters worse, the PSP theoretically has access to the entire system memory space. AMD either will not or cannot deny this, and it would seem to be required to allow the DRM features to work as intended, which means that it has, at a minimum, MMIO-based access to the network controllers and any other PCI, PCIe peripherals installed on the system. In theory, any malicious entity with access to the AMD signing key would be able to install persistent malware that could not be eradicated without an external flasher and a known good PSP image. Furthermore, multiple security vulnerabilities have been demonstrated in AMD firmware in the past, and there is even reason to assume one or more zero-day vulnerabilities are lurking in the PSP firmware. AMD's PSP can also act as a tyrant by checking signatures on any boot firmware that you flash, making replacement boot firmware impossible on some boards. If the PSP firmware is not present, or if the AMD signing key is not present, the x86 cores will not be released from reset, rendering the system inoperable. Libreboot, a project for free, open-source BIOS firmware, recommends avoiding all modern AMD hardware because of this. They call on AMD to release the source code, which AMD has sadly confirmed is something they will not do. This refusal feels even more sinister when one recalls a report that speculated the NSA may have backdoors built into Intel and AMD processors. One of Silicon Valley's most respected technology experts, Steve Blank, says he would be surprised if the US National Security Agency was not embedding backdoors inside chips produced by Intel and AMD. Mr. Blank, who began his career working as a National Security Agency contractor at his Pine Gap facility, is an expert in the microprocessors or chips inside every computer, having helped start two semiconductor companies and a supercomputer firm. Mr. Blank said when he learned the NSA had secured pre-encryption stage access to Microsoft's email products via the Prism leaks, he recognized that pretty much all our computers have a way for the NSA to get inside their hardware before a user can even think about applying encryption or other defensive measures. This explains why people were nervous about the platform security processor and dismayed by AMD's refusal to release the source code. To instill some confidence in its greatest skeptics, AMD said that they employed third-party security teams to keep beating away at its PSP, which has been ongoing since the start of the year. Apparently, CTS Labs beat them to the punch by releasing their white paper, which unearthed some very interesting, if troubling, information. The Chimera set of vulnerabilities are set by manufacturers' backdoors left on the AMD chipset. Developed by Taiwanese company AS Media, this allows for an attacker to inject malicious code into the chip and take over the chipset, read, write, and execute. One set of backdoors is implemented in firmware, while the other is implemented in the actual logic gates of the chip, ASIC. Both yield the same impact. Physical access is not required. An attacker would only need to be able to run an EXE with local admin privileges on the machine. This is the same case with the last flaw. The master key set of vulnerabilities enable an attacker to execute unsigned code inside the PSP, totaling a complete compromise of the secure processor. The exploit reflashes the BIOS to take advantage of the vulnerability. On some motherboards, this works out of the box. This is because the PSP firmware is often ignored by BIOS signature checks. CTS Labs said with these vulnerabilities, a malicious actor can take control over Ryzen and EPYC secure processors, take control over Ryzen chipsets, infect AMD chips with malware, steal credentials on high security enterprise networks, evade virtually all endpoint security solutions, and cause physical damage to hardware. These vulnerabilities were acknowledged by Mark Papermaster, Senior Vice President and Chief Technology Officer at AMD, who promised to release firmware patches through BIOS updates. AMD insists these mitigations have no performance impact. While AMD CPUs are also vulnerable to some Spectre variants, they are immune to the vulnerabilities that affect Intel's hyperthreading. Consequently, Ryzen users can continue using simultaneous multi-threading without worrying about security. As for the few vulnerabilities AMD has, their mitigations hurt performance far less than Intel's fixes. If looking at the geometric mean for the tests, the Intel systems all saw about 16% lower performance out of the box now with these default mitigations, and obviously even lower if disabling hyperthreading for maximum security. The two AMD systems tested saw a 3% performance hit with the default mitigations. To be fair, these tests compared the 8700K and second generation Ryzen. Intel reinforced their 9th generation processors with hardware fixes for Spectre and Meltdown. Foronix ran another test with the 9900K and 3rd generation Ryzen. This was their result. If looking at the geometric mean for these various mitigation-sensitive benchmarks, the default mitigations on the Core i9-9900K amounted to a 28% hit, while the Ryzen 7 2700X saw a 5% hit with its default Spectre mitigations, and the new Ryzen 7 3700X came in at 6%, and the Ryzen 9 3900X at just over 5%. Can Intel recover from this? Yes, at a cost. Dropping prices. Intel's i9-9900K will be significantly more competitive at $400, the price it should have launched at. Intel does not appear to be aloof to this, going by their internal memo. We expect their pricing to be significantly below ours, so they'll likely get good performance per dollar. That's what they're going to compete on, and that's the risk to Intel. So, compete. Drop your price and mitigate this risk. Intel is a premium brand. That doesn't sound good. Intel is aware of their mindshare and think they can continue charging consumers through the nose. Hopefully AMD can chip away at this with their Ryzen's lead in multi-threaded performance. Still, Intel will enjoy a noticeable lead in gaming until developers learn to optimize their games for 12 cores and beyond, since the 9900K has neutralized AMD's monopoly over 8 cores on mainstream CPUs. Not sure monopoly is the correct term there. AMD did the right thing. It's Intel's fault they were stagnant for half a decade. At times, and on some workloads, we might dip below on performance, like the second half of this year. Some workloads? Don't you mean the vast majority? At other times and on other workloads, we are 3 times or more the performance. At other times? Do you mean the past? Our pricing will continue to reflect the value we deliver to our customers. So you mean your prices will drop? Like the drop in value brought by your product's vulnerabilities and the subsequent performance hit caused by your mitigations? It sure seemed that way when outlets reported Intel was considering cutting the 9th generation prices by 10 to 15%. If this was accurate, we'd be seeing the 9900K sell for $414 to $439. That hasn't happened yet. The only CPU available at $439 is the 9900KF, a variant that lacks the integrated graphics that are indispensable in video editing. Just as a reminder, Intel's hardware acceleration can help the 9900K render videos in less than half the time taken by the 3900X. This is what you lose if you purchase this cheaper i9. It would appear these reports on the impending price cut were fabricated, or maybe Intel had second thoughts. Would price cuts hurt public perception of our products being the premium brand? Perhaps Intel thinks the only path forward is to compete with their next generation. This was hinted at by German outlet Computerbase, who on July 9, 2019 published an article of a slide they came upon. This leak claims Intel is enabling hyperthreading across all 10th generation CPUs, from the i3 to the i9. This seems unlikely, considering hyperthreading has been labeled a security risk. Indeed, this is what the researchers who uncovered Zombie Load had to say. Disabling hyperthreading is the only possible workaround to prevent this extremely powerful attack on current processors. The leak claims hyperthreading has doubled the thread counts of the i5 and i7, though their core counts have not changed. As for the i9, the leak claims Intel has bumped the flagship up to 10 cores and 20 threads, while keeping the price at $499, with slower variants at $409 and $449. Curiously, the leak hinted Intel might drop integrated graphics from the entire i9 lineup. This leak had a few flaws that drew suspicion, like the dollar sign after the price and the apostrophe after SKU, a typo Intel is unlikely to repeat after their ninth generation slide. However, this information was bolstered by another set of slides, though these were leaked by X-Fastest, an outlet from Hong Kong. These leaks include a roadmap that placed Comet Lake's launch in the first quarter of 2020, and a platform overview that concurred with the German leak of the new flagship being a 10-core 20-thread chip. Furthermore, the format of this presentation looks remarkably similar to an early leak of Coffee Lake back in 2017. The Coffee Lake leak predicted a 6-core flagship which turned out to be accurate, which may make some people more likely to believe X-Fastest's leak. However, there were a few differences between the two Comet Lake leaks, namely the thermal design power. X-Fastest's platform overview fixes the enthusiast power at 125 watts, while the processor detail slide pegs the flagship TDP at 105 watts. Which one is more accurate? Neither, according to Gamers Nexus, who had this to say. We spoke with sources close to the matter and confirmed that this slide is not made by Intel and is a fake slide. Similar to rumors of 5 GHz Ryzen CPUs for Zen 2, it's probably best just to ignore them. Damn. It's a shame, since a 10-core Intel CPU would have given the 3900X a run for its money. Sadly, we will have to wait until 2020 for Intel's response to AMD's 7-nanometer competition. If you've been holding out for Ryzen 3000, we'd say you've waited long enough. Third-generation Ryzen may not be perfect, but AM4 sure seems like it. This is a platform of the present and the future, something that cannot be said of Intel's chipsets. Intel doesn't have to be this way. They could, if they were so inclined, let consumers upgrade their CPU without requiring them to purchase a new motherboard. Indeed, enthusiasts have managed to overclock the 9900K to a staggering 5.5 GHz on a two-generation-old Z170 motherboard. This is what Tom's Hardware had to say about it. Despite all the roadblocks that Intel has put in place, modders and overclockers around the hardware world eventually found a way to get Coffee Lake processors to work on the old Z170 and Z270 motherboards. The workaround requires a fair bit of trickery that includes modifying Intel's management engine, ME, and the motherboard's BIOS. How could Intel possibly justify impeding their own customers with unnecessary roadblocks? The answer is obvious. These roadblocks force customers to purchase newer motherboards, providing Intel with another source of revenue. They have been able to get away with this solely due to a historical lack of competition. We hope Ryzen forces them to get their act together and stop shafting consumers with these ridiculous requirements. And that concludes our take on AMD's new processors. If you like this video, please share it. Our next video will analyze if Navi is a GPU of the future and what this means for older Radeon cards. So please like, subscribe, and press the bell button so you don't miss out. Several subscribers have reported that YouTubers screw them with their notifications, even when the bell button is enabled. So if that's true, just keep an eye out for our thumbnails. Help us, channel subscribers. You're our only hope. New videos will also be announced on Twitter, so please follow us over there too. Link is in the comments and the description below. We have a secondary channel we're using as a backup, just in case. So head over to there and like and subscribe that one too. While you're here, feel free to watch our analysis on Denuvo's history and performance impact, our analysis of Battlefield 5's controversies, and our hardware analysis of CPUs and graphics cards.